Good evening and welcome to St. Thomas. This weekend we celebrate the 19th Sunday of Ordinary Time. Our celebrant this evening is our pastor, Father Ray, and he is being assisted by Deacon David. Please remember to silence all cell phones or anything that makes noise. And our opening hymn can be found on the green sheet. It is How Firm a Foundation. Please stand and sing.
Celebrate today the 19th Sunday in Ordinary Time. The Gospel of Jesus speaks to the disciples who are frightened and the message that he offers to them. Take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid. Such is the message he offers to you and me this night as well. Take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid. Let us pause now to look within our hearts to see if we truly take that courage the Lord invites us to receive. Sisters and brothers, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Lord Jesus, you love us as we are. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you offer us the gift of courage. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you challenge us to let go of fear and receive that courage. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, whom taught by the Holy Spirit, we dare to call our Father. Bring, we pray, to perfection in our hearts the spirit of adoption as your sons and daughters, that we may merit to enter into the inheritance which you have promised. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Kings. At the mountain of God, Horeb, Elijah came to a cave where he took shelter. Then the Lord said to him, "Go outside and stand on the mountain before the Lord. The Lord will be passing by." A strong and heavy wind was rending the mountains and crushing rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, there was fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. After the fire, there was a tiny whispering sound. When he heard this, Elijah hid his face in his cloak and went and stood at the entrance of the cave. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, I speak the truth in Christ, I do not lie. My conscience joins with the Holy Spirit in bearing me witness that I have great sorrow and constant anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself was accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred, according to the flesh. They are Israelites. Theirs the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. Theirs the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, is the Christ, who is over all, God, blessed forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Dismissed the crowds. After doing so, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When it was evening, he was there alone. Meanwhile, the boat, already a few miles offshore, was being tossed about by the waves, for the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, he came toward them, walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified. "It is a ghost," they said, and they cried out in fear. At once Jesus spoke to them, "Take courage, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter said to him in reply, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." Peter got out of the boat and began to walk on the water toward Jesus. But when he saw how strong the wind was, he became frightened. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught Peter and said to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" After they got into the boat, wind died down. Those who were in the boat did him homage, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Many jokes have a similar format. It's very common for a joke to begin, "A man walked into a bar." However, the joke I offer to you is a little variation on that. And the variation on it is this. A penguin walked into a bar. A little different. A penguin walked into the bar and there went up to the bartender. And the penguin said, "Excuse me, sir, have you seen my father?" The bartender hesitated for a moment and he said, "I'm not sure. What does he look like?" What does he look like? I wonder if I were to ask you, "Have you seen God?" Would you come back with a similar response? "I'm not sure. What does he look like? What does God look like? Where do we look for God? How do we find God?" I'm blessed to have a magnificent community here at St. Thomas with absolutely outstanding theologians. And there's a question that I ask many times, and you've never gotten the answer wrong yet. I have absolute confidence that you get it right again tonight. The question is this. If a four-year-old were to come up to you and ask you, "Where is God?" What would you respond? "God is
everywhere."
What a brilliant group. I am so blessed to have you here. God is everywhere. It is one of the key elements of our belief. Our God is Emmanuel, a God with us. Our God is everywhere. And so if I were to ask you, "Have you seen God?" you could give me an infinite number of potential places where you saw God. That you could see God in almost any type of event, in almost any type of situation. Have you seen God? Have you encountered God? Well, maybe you say, "Well, it's just really hard to say. I don't know for sure." And in the Gaelic spirituality, they have a wonderful way of talking about what is called thin places, T-H-I-N, thin places. The idea is that there is a veil that keeps us from seeing God clearly while we're here on earth. But some places that veil is thinner than others. And so the opportunity of seeing God through the veil, but through a very thin veil. What would those thin places be like? What would be an experience of such a thin opportunity? Three thoughts that I would offer to you tonight. Three places to see God. Absolutely, you can see God anywhere, but three places that are thin places. Three places where many people see God. Three places where you and I might see God. The first, in the sacraments. We as Catholic Christians are a sacramental people. Sacraments are a key part of our belief, a key part of our faith. And so you gathered here this evening to celebrate the Eucharist, to encounter Christ in the Eucharist, to see God in this Eucharist. Indeed, the Eucharist is called the sacrament par excellence. In this sacrament, Jesus offers himself to the Father and calls us to join him. Jesus is the head of the body of Christ. You and I as members of the body of Christ. And here in this celebration, you will have an opportunity of receiving Holy Communion, the body and blood and soul and divinity of Christ, to see Christ in the Eucharist, to see Christ in that reception of Holy Communion. Indeed, it's not just the Eucharist, but all the sacraments, an opportunity to see Christ, an opportunity to see God. To see God in the sacrament of baptism, in the sacrament of confirmation, to see God in the sacrament of reconciliation, in the sacrament of the anointing of the sick, to see God in the sacrament of matrimony, to see God in the sacrament of holy orders. It is a thin place, a place where God reveals himself so clearly. To see God, to encounter God, one place to do that is first the sacraments. To see God, to encounter God, a second place would be in times of quiet prayer. Indeed, such an important part of our faith. It's something that I come back to time and time again, inviting you to have a daily time of prayer, a daily quiet time, a daily time to be with the Lord. Indeed, all the spiritual masters will indicate that that is an essential part of growth in the spiritual life. Some will talk about a long period of time, others maybe 10 minutes. Bishop Ken Utner used to talk about 6 minutes. But to do that every day without fail, to have that time with God alone, that quiet time, such as the experience in the gospel today. Jesus had fed the 5,000. He sends the disciples off, and then he goes to the top of a mountain alone, there to encounter God. Some will talk about it as being alone with God alone. Is there a time of that in your life each day? Do you make time to be with God alone? Well, you say, well, Father, wait, I'm with God every moment of every day. Absolutely. But so often there are others involved as well, which is perfectly fine. But to have that quiet time, that time with God alone. Our first reading, one of my favorite readings, we're reading from the book of Kings. And it's the experience of Elijah, and something that is so revelatory to me. Elijah is told that the Lord is going to be coming by. And so he's alert that he will recognize the Lord when the Lord comes. And so he's paying special attention. And first, there is a strong and mighty wind. A wind so strong that it's breaking up rocks. But God was not in the wind. And second, after that, is an earthquake. But God was not in the earthquake. And third, after that, is a fire. But God was not in the fire. And fourth, there was a tiny whispering sound. God was present in that tiny whispering sound. I wonder, if God wanted to speak to you or me through a tiny whispering sound, would that be possible? Is there a time when you would hear that? Our lives are so busy. There's so much noise in our life. If God wanted to speak to you in that tiny whispering sound, would there be a quiet time in your day when you would hear it? When you would recognize that it was God speaking to you? The second, to see God, to encounter God in quiet times of prayer. The third, to experience God, to see God in times of crisis, in times of struggle. Indeed, that is such an important part of our faith, that God is with us always, but especially with us in difficult times. When you go through those difficult times, to have a sense of God's presence. Have you had those difficult times? Are you aware of those difficult times? Perhaps it may have to do with things regarding work, or perhaps it may have to do with things regarding family. Perhaps it may have to do with the death of a loved one, or perhaps it may have to do with illness, or perhaps it may have to do with something entirely different that you alone would know. But to experience God in a time of crisis, to see God in a time of struggle. There's a famous adage that there are no atheists in foxholes, and there's a reason for that. When things get really tough, to look for God. When things get really tough, to trust in God. So it happens two times in today's gospel. The second of those times, Jesus is walking on the water, and Peter recognizes him. And Peter says, Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you. And so the Lord says, come. And so Peter begins to walk on the water toward Jesus. But as he's walking on the water, looking at Jesus, everything is going fine. But then he takes his eyes off Jesus and looks down at the water. And he begins to sink. And he cries out, Lord, save me. And then the response of Jesus, the response, a particular way that he responded. So very important, the first word. Immediately, Jesus reached out to touch Peter. That here Peter was in a situation where he thought he might drown. And the Lord reached out to him immediately. Prior to that, in the gospel, after Jesus had sent the disciples off, after he had had his time of prayer, he's walking on the water toward the disciples. The disciples see him. They become very much afraid. They think it is a ghost. And the message that Jesus offers to them, take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid. That's the message Jesus is offering to you. That's the message that Jesus is offering to me tonight. Take courage. Do not be afraid. It is I. Is that the way you experience your relationship with Jesus? That you receive that courage? That you know that Jesus is with us? Indeed, I think with the coronavirus, so many of us are experiencing difficulties. So many of us are experiencing struggles. For many of us, this is a crisis time. A crisis time with regard to the illness. A crisis time with regard to the ramifications that come from the illness. Perhaps it is a time of fear for you. Perhaps a time of great struggle for you. The invitation that I would offer to you is to look to Jesus. That Jesus is with you. That Jesus will strengthen and help you in the midst of that struggle, in the midst of that crisis, in the midst of that difficulty, the line that he offers to the disciples is the same message he offers to you and to me. Take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid. The third, to experience Jesus in times of struggle and crisis. And so it is that today I come to bring you good news. Good news of God who is with us always. Good news of our opportunity to experience God in every circumstance of life. But especially the opportunity to experience God in thin places. To experience God in the celebration of the sacraments. To experience God in quiet times of prayer. To experience God in times of crisis and struggle. A God who is with us always. Jesus who says to you and to me, take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid. We'll stand. Let us together profess our faith, a profession of faith which be the Apostles' Creed. We pray together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. My sisters and brothers, confident in God's love and care, confident in God who is with us always, let us now bring to God our needs and the needs of all our world.
Our prayer response is, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Pope Francis, Bishop Stephen Reika, and all who serve the Church, that we may recognize the presence of God in our midst, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all leaders of nations, that they may seek peace and justice, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who are struggling in any way because of the coronavirus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who make their livelihoods from oceans, seas, and rivers, that they may be blessed for their efforts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the prayers that we offer in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those in our parish work of intentions, the sick, the homebound, the incarcerated, all members of St. Thomas, the men and women of the armed forces and their families, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who have died in the peace of Christ, may Wilson Bacoo receive the gift of eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Gracious and loving God, hear the prayers we bring before you, and strengthen and help us to place our trust in you and to receive courage from your gifts to us. We pray through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands.
Please, O Lord, to accept the offerings of your church, for in your mercy you have given them to be offered, and by your power you transform them into the mystery of our salvation, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. So that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Stephen, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, All glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. In the communion in your sacrament that we have consumed, save us, O Lord, and confirm us in the light of your truth, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A few announcements to share with you. Thank you for your understanding with regard to the precautions being taken in light of the coronavirus. There's not a recessional hymn today, but rather instrumental music. We would ask that you use social distancing as you leave the church. Please leave any papers you do not want to bring home off the seat of the pew, as we do not reuse any papers. Again, we would ask you not to linger in the gathering area, to go directly to the courtyard or to the parking lot. Next Saturday is August 15th, the Feast of the Assumption. Normally, this is a holy day of obligation. It's not a day of obligation this year for two reasons. First, because of Bishop Raker's dispensation due to the coronavirus. And secondly, because it falls on a Saturday. However, it is a major feast day. St. Thomas will celebrate the Feast of the Assumption with Mass at 10 a.m. On Saturday next week. We're blessed to have Bishop Stephen Raker to come to visit us tomorrow. He will celebrate the 11 o'clock Mass and greet people afterwards. I know you've now already been at Mass this weekend. Tomorrow's another day. You might want to come back again. You'd be more than welcome. Chance to meet Bishop Raker if you're able to come tomorrow, and we will celebrate the 11 o'clock Mass. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.